cooking. When our grocery store, we sold their herrings that came in a barrel. And sometimes the herring smelled so good, and sometimes it smelled so bad. But everybody at Goose Steak loves herring. I had one herring in the barrel, and a lady came in, and she said, "I'd like a small herring." So I put my hand in the barrel, and I pulled out the only herring that I had in it. So she said to me, "Oh, this tapestry, oh, it's so beautiful. But maybe you have one with a bit of it, and that was a fat bag." So I put the herring back in the barrel, and I pulled out the same herring. And she said, "Oh, it's kind of beautiful. I think I'll take both of them." Jewish grocers that we recognize tonight were those who did not come and serve us. We had a surprise for you. Our video will introduce you to several who were with us 5 years in the mid-19th century. Abraham Jacobs, the secretary of that famous Moonlight League, was the grocer, a Jewish grocer, as well as surprise.
Was driving the area back to store run by Mario and Diana Friedman. When the fish were bought in Colorado, beginning in the 1930s. Max Stein moved to Pueblo, Colorado from New York City in 1892 at the age of 18. Like so many grocers, Stein began as a huckster, peddling food and vegetables door to door. At the turn of the century, Stein opened his first grocery store in Pueblo. And in 1904, he moved to a more modern outlet on the corner of 4th and Grand Street. Around 1911, Max Stein sold his store and joined the Pueblo police force. Sherwin was one of the first non-Mormon policemen. But in 1915, he returned to his first life, the grocery game, and opened Stein Grocery in Newport. He was later joined by his son, Manuel. Today, the business is still in the same location, but has expanded to have a wholesale food company, run for many years by Max's grandson, Martin Stein, until the business was sold. As Eastern European Jews migrated to Colorado at the turn of the century, the grocery business again became a means of supporting immigrant families. And the mom-and-pop store became a vehicle to upward economic control. Radetzky's family had first come to Colorado with the Cotopaxi agricultural colony in the 1880s. When the colony, which was populated by 50 Russian Jews, failed due to adverse local conditions, those moved to Denver's west side to form the nucleus of the Eastern European Jewish community. Max was a carpenter by trade who worked for the Denver and Rio Grande Western Railroad, building home coaches. Decided to go into business for themselves, opening a grocery at 12th and Lambert in about 1916. The store carried a general line of products, plus many tobacco items. Max was given an ultimatum by his railroad employers, who were unhappy about his dual career, and both men went back to their regular jobs after about a year or two. However, the Pinto family, who purchased the store from the two anchors, turned it into a successful enterprise. Other Jewish-run groceries on the east side of Denver included the Gem Market, located at about 2958 Denver and operated by Leonard Levin, Hunter Linda Levin often visited the store for coffee. Leonard's mother, Becky Levin, operated her own small mom-and-pop store at 1642 South Broadway. Becky's husband, Harry, was a barber who worked on the next block. The little grocery was located in the front of their house.
My grandmother's where I'm from. Sported many Jewish-run grocers. Abraham Sachs operated a grocery store at 37th and Humboldt in 1916. He is pictured here with his family in front of his new store on the corner of 25th and Curtis. The plates featured in the window represent the artwork that was his real application. One of the later East Side groceries was operated by Sachs and Silverman Levin. They opened Michael Dell Contestant in Creamery in 1948, located at 8th Avenue and Colorado Boulevard. They offered dairy milk, canned goods, soft drinks, cheese, and toaster-style meats. Other than the high holidays, Sam and Elaine operated the store 7 days a week and 52 weeks a year, until they finally took a vacation in 1959. Their son Michael used to accompany his father, delivering Passover orders to neighborhood homes. During the early years, with Elaine running the store, Sam held a second job delivering candy and tobacco products around Denver, even as far away as Elizabeth and Franklin. In 1955, the business became Michael Dell Contestant and Pizza, which has moved to larger quarters over the years. Each of the European cities he located in Denver's West Side immigrant neighborhood. Often turned into grocery business because it required a relatively modest capital investment, but much hard work and determination. Commodities that the immigrants possessed in great quantity. Although children were often expected to work in the store during vacations and after school, most parents pushed their children out of the store and to college. Here's Richtol, the father of the grocery store in West Broadway. Recalls that opening one's own grocery was often the only way to support a family without working on the Jewish Sabbath. It was not unusual for the elder Richtol to hitch up his horse wagon to deliver cream to a customer at 10 p.m., even when the margin of profit was less than 2 cents. Abe Winifred was facing his final call for conscription into the Tsar's army in Russia in 1909, when he decided to immigrate to America. Because he had a lotsman who lived in Denver, he made Colorado his destination. After a variety of jobs, he opened his own small grocery store, first on the edge of downtown Denver and later in the West Colfax area, next to Bosco's Bakery. which later became Star Bakery. Star Bakery, located at 2744 West Colfax, was founded in 1907 by Eva and Jacob Boskowitz, and later continued by his sons, Rudy and Sam Bosko. Star Bread was delivered fresh to the Westside Grocers daily. Lewis or Libby Ginsburg had more success with his store for Born in Rochester in 1872, Libby called his first Delta last name GINSDPRG. RG on the storefront, the family changed the name rather than pay the sign people to correct it. Most were mom and pop enterprises, with the family working long and hard saving money with the hope of seeing their children enter the profession. Often the family lived behind the grocery store. Justice and Clara Rosen operated various small mom and pop stores under the Colfax Viaduct from the late 1930s through the 1960s. Joe's brother Phil opened his store on the hill. Clara's brother, Max Rosen, operated his own small grocery on West Colfax, across from the camp at the metal temple. Max later sold Andy grocery to his sister, Blanche Rosen Smith, who met her future husband in the grocery when he came in to buy a sandwich. In the late 1940s and 1950s, the inns were still heard of West Side Street. Phil's Grocery opened in 1947 on the corner of West Colfax and Knox Court, then moved in 1950 across the street. As was the case with most of these local groceries, in the beginning it catered to the Jewish community and sold only kosher products. Phil's wife Libby also worked in the store, and so did their son Sherwin.
I have a beautiful love story to tell about a grocer's love for his customer. We had a little customer that lived across the street from our store, and she had no one. She had no family. All she had was her little chickens, and she used to talk to the chickens and eat it. My husband adored this little lady, and he took care of many of her needs. He was in the hospital and had a heart attack at 61, and this little lady died. I went to the funeral, and at the cemetery, there was quite a discussion who was going to say cottage for her. I came home from the hot cemetery, and I was very heartsick. And my husband called me, and he said, "Did you know this little lady died?" And I said, "Of course I knew. I just went to the funeral." He said, "You know, dear, I had always planned on saying cottage for her, but I can't do it now. And she had given me $50 to pay someone to say cottage for her for the year. I want you to take $50 and go to one of the rabbis and give them the money and make sure that the cottage is set for her for the entire year."
A lot of the grocers used to come into our store and do the final hotel house. We were 18. Dancing and Harry Singer, and they'd come in and they would take the stock off the shelf or order through our book. And I'd say to my husband, "Do you know what name she took?" I guess he said, "Do you know what Harry took?" He said, "No. But those guys will pay me." And they did the next day and come in today. And that's how we insisted.
Long hours, personal service, charge accounts, and home delivery were the norm in these mom and pop We'll be right back. grocery store on the ninth floor in Colfax for 100 years, and his wife and children also worked in the store. In the middle 1940s, he bought a truck and sold fruit and vegetables on the west side. Behind the back of the store, raising two sons.
Very first time thing that I remember was a visit of his work. And when I was about 6 or 7, the store opened, especially at 7 o'clock, and I think that people were there early. And I felt sorry for my parents for having breakfast. I remember we had big 5 pound blocks. My favorite was marble, and it was not, if you cut it properly, didn't use a knife, use a string. And also we had big blocks of cream cheese, and we were reminiscing about Passover. We had been back to the stores to all the grocers. Our bedrooms were filled with things, our dining room was filled with joy rings, all about joy rings, we had raspberry gel rings, we had the orange gel rings. I remember we delivered Passover orders all over the city of Denver. I was not old enough to drive. My father, Oliver Fulham, was driving our 1953 Chevrolet station wagon. Loaded so full that the back bumper was about that much off the ground going over the Colfax fire.
Most of the early growth of Perlov was started by Eastern European immigrants. However, Perlov, which was started in 1925 and located on West Colfax in Osceola, was an exception. 16-year-old Perlov give up.
imagine how we're going to manage, but we got started. We just didn't know what we were going to do with the deliveries and everything else. Mine was in town, but he was working for every night. He would come to help us, and he would take deliveries, and his car was there. But anyway, the door opened to this door, and there was Wesley. And he said, "Wesley, what are you doing here? You've got finals." He said, "I know I have finals." So I went to every one of my professors and told him I had a Christmas first. And then he went out for Passover. Every one of them said, "Go, we will give you a finals place." And such sacrifices they all made. And everything all the grocers did with one another, especially the Jewish grocers.
There was never a feeling of competition, there was a feeling of love.
There is no longer a grocery store on the ground. The rise of e-commerce firms transformed the grocery business by 1950. In the 1950s, most of the children of the grocers had already gone to the profession from other businesses. Only a few Jewish grocers came along. Yet the dream of those Jewish